Hey guys, welcome back to another video. This one's going to be on COVID-19 and autoimmunity. So long COVID and multi-system inflammatory disease, these are scientifically mysterious complications of COVID-19. And COVID-19 by itself is a mysterious disease in a lot of ways, despite us already knowing a lot about it. Scientists are working hard to unravel the cause and effect of the interaction between the SARS-CoV-2 virus and the immune system. COVID causes several symptoms that may point to a phenomenon called autoimmunity as a potential cause of long COVID. Now, this includes pulmonary fibrosis, meaning scarring of the lungs. Unfortunately, I'm seeing the same picture unfold in so many of my patients in the pulmonary clinic, where they've had COVID-19 and now they have a lot of scarring in their lungs as a result of that. And COVID can cause other issues like brain changes. We've all heard about the brain fog. It can cause skin rashes, excessive blood clotting, inflamed blood vessels, and more. Autoimmunity is when the immune system mounts an attack on its own healthy cells and tissues, mistaking them for foreign or virally infected cells. Now, under normal conditions, the immune system can discriminate between self and foreigners, meaning it can differentiate between the body's proteins and foreign antigens. But sometimes in some people, the immune system can mistakenly identify its own proteins as foreign antigens, and it launches its attack on itself. Now, when these autoantibodies react against self antigens, the outcome can be inflammation and damage to tissues. This is what happens with autoimmune diseases such as type 1 diabetes, Graves' disease, multiple sclerosis, and more. This is also what happens with idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, where people get scarring in their lungs, much in the same way that happens with COVID. In fact, there are a lot of autoimmune conditions that can result in scarring in the lungs or pulmonary fibrosis. This includes things like lupus, scleroderma, polymyositis, rheumatoid arthritis, and ankylosing spondylitis. The vast majority of people who get COVID will have disease that is isolated to the upper respiratory tract. But in 20% of people who get the infection, it'll go deep into the lung parenchyma and have the potential to cause more severe disease, meaning COVID pneumonia, which sometimes blossoms into ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome. The question of autoimmunity as a potential cause of more severe COVID disease, that was brought up when autopsies of people who died of COVID-19 revealed an inconsistency between the viral load and the degree of lung damage. This disconnect led to researchers to surmise that the immune system is more responsible than the virus for causing the extensive and often irreparable lung damage. A study that hasn't yet been peer-reviewed enrolled 147 hospitalized patients with COVID-19 in 3 medical centers. They measured autoantibodies that were associated with connective tissue diseases, for example, lupus. They also measured other antibodies like anti-cytokine antibodies and antiviral antibodies. Now, compared to a healthy control group, autoantibodies were more commonly found in people who had COVID-19. Researchers found autoantibodies in half of hospitalized COVID patients, compared to less than 15% who were healthy and uninfected. Now, in some, the autoantibodies didn't change throughout the course of illness. However, in 20%, the autoantibodies increased as the disease progressed. It takes several weeks for autoantibodies to build up, which may explain the delay in developing symptoms of severe COVID-19. There was a study done at Rockefeller University in New York that enrolled almost 1,000 patients with severe COVID. About 10% had antibodies that blocked the action of type 1 interferon molecules, which is a protein that helps the immune system fight pathogens. These autoantibodies were more common in men at 12.5% compared to women at 2.6%. This may explain why men are more likely to have more severe disease. The researchers in the study are now screening 40,000 people to see what proportion of uninfected people carry these antibodies and their distribution by age, ancestry, and gender. Now, this data will be compared to the distribution and percentage of each factor in people with severe COVID. Researchers in another study supported the finding of increased autoantibodies in COVID patients. The antibodies they found were directed towards B cells, a type of immune cell that produces antibodies, and interferon. Although the researchers noted that they found no COVID-19-specific autoantibodies that distinguished COVID-19 patients from uninfected controls, the levels of autoantibodies were correlated with known markers of inflammation and the correlations became more extreme as the disease worsened. Other researchers and yet-to-be peer-reviewed study found that anti-annexin antibodies were elevated among hospitalized COVID-19 patients with the highest levels in those who died. Antibodies that inhibit annexin's activity can cause widespread blood clotting, cellular death, and swelling in lung tissue. The authors concluded that these anti-annexin antibody levels predicted mortality. Have other viruses been implicated in forming autoantibodies? Well, case reports from as early as 1984 show autoantibodies against interferon after a viral infection with varicella zoster. Viruses that have been proposed as triggers for autoimmune disorders include parvovirus B19, Epstein-Barr virus, cytomegalovirus, herpes virus 6, hepatitis A, hepatitis C, and rubella. So the Epstein-Barr virus, which causes mononucleosis or mono, has been linked to many autoimmune disorders, including lupus. Streptococcus pyogenes, the bacteria that causes strep throat, can prompt an autoimmune reaction called rheumatic fever, in addition to glomerulonephritis, which is a kidney condition. Rheumatic fever can cause permanent heart damage after attacking heart cells, aka myocytes. Helicobacter pylori is a bacteria that can cause infection of the stomach, and this bacterial infection is thought to be a trigger for developing immune thrombocytopenic purpura, aka ITP. ITP is an autoimmune attack on platelets, which are responsible for blood clotting, at least partially responsible for blood clotting. SARS-CoV-2 has been linked to several autoimmune disorders. There's been a case report of a 65-year-old female with COVID-19, in addition to another case report of a pediatric patient, and they each developed ITP. Recently, I did a video on a doctor in Florida who died as a result of bleeding because of thrombocytopenia, meaning low platelets. His platelet level went all the way down to zero. This happened shortly after he got the first dose of the Pfizer vaccine. Did this vaccine cause this, or instead did he get the SARS-CoV-2 infection and that caused the low platelets? Or was there another undiagnosed condition that was flying under the radar, such as leukemia, that led to low platelets and led to his outcome? It's easy to jump to conclusions, but based on the timing, it seems like it was related to the vaccine, but there's no way to know for sure right now. That's why an autopsy is necessary, but even then, doing an autopsy doesn't necessarily guarantee that we'll get a definitive answer. But getting back to SARS-CoV-2, there are case reports of people developing other autoimmune diseases like Guillain-Barré syndrome, a progressive ascending, meaning it rises up, symmetric paralysis. Guillain-Barré syndrome is a relatively rare immune-mediated disease that may be triggered by respiratory viruses or vaccination. Antiphospholipid antibodies have been found in many patients with COVID-19. Antiphospholipid antibody syndrome is the major cause of strokes in people with systemic autoimmune disorders. These antibodies are normally found in about 0.5% of the population. They've also been found in many, but not all, patients who've had COVID-19 and blood clots. The findings of increased autoantibodies in patients with severe COVID are intriguing, but critics point out that the control group in many of these studies were healthy, uninfected people, not people infected with another virus. And the findings of autoantibodies were not always consistent with clinical findings. Further studies comparing the effects of autoantibodies in COVID-19 with autoantibody production in influenza may help determine a pattern of autoantibody production that is more classic in COVID-19. Cytokine storms are an overreaction by the immune system and are more systemic and short-term. In contrast, autoantibodies are more targeted and long-term. Dexamethasone, which is a corticosteroid, along with the arthritic drugs tocilizumab and sirolimumab, they've been used to modulate an overactive immune response. In a clinical trial, tocilizumab and sirolimumab improved outcomes for critically ill patients on a ventilator in the intensive care unit. These medications require careful timing to interrupt an overreactive immune system without interfering with a normal immune system fighting the COVID-19 infection. COVID is often a biphasic illness with an initial phase that is primarily respiratory symptoms caused by the virus and then the immediate immune response with innate immunity. And sometimes that's later followed up with a secondary inflammatory phase. Researchers have found that medications that are helpful in one stage can actually be harmful if administered at the wrong time. For example, remdesivir, an antiviral medication, has not been beneficial in the later stages of COVID-19. So there are two arms of the immune system. On one hand, you have the non-specific innate immune system, and then you have the specific adaptive immune system. Whenever you're infected with a pathogen that is new to your immune system, you rely on the innate immune system to fight the pathogen. Interferons are proteins that are part of that initial innate response. Interferon beta is one of the first cytokines produced and drives the innate immune response in the lung. This connection illustrates the importance of the finding that SARS-CoV-2 may inhibit interferon activity in those who develop more severe COVID. There has been a randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled pilot study in 9 UK hospitals in which they enrolled 98 patients, 50 to the control group, and then 48 to the treatment group. In the treatment group, they gave nebulized inhaled interferon. The two groups were then well-matched demographically, and the results showed that the treatment group seemed to improve more quickly compared to the control group, although the results were not statistically significant, and a larger trial is now in the works. Could autoantibodies be formed to help halt an immune system that is out of control? Well, the two factors that determine the outcome of a COVID-19 infection are the viral load and the quality and quantity of the immune response. A high viral load can do more damage before the immune system can bring it under control. An immune system with a poor antibody or cellular response can't mount a response fast enough or strong enough to limit the infection's damage. Now, on the other hand, an immune response that is not well regulated will lead to tissue damage secondary to that inflammation. A study showed that the autoantibodies were still present 7 months after infection, leading researchers to stress the need to determine whether there's a link between autoantibodies and long COVID. These studies, they raise many questions, but they can also be avenues to new treatment options. So that's going to be all for this video. Thanks for watching. Subscribe if you haven't done so already. Hit that bell notification. That way you know when my next one's coming out, and I'll see you in the next one.